Thank you all for joining us today, learning a little bit more about how to protect your business data against all the current threats out there. My name is Mike DePalma. I am the channel development manager for a company called Datto. We are a business continuity solution provider based out of Norwalk, so just about 45 miles east of Manhattan. Very quick 30-second overview of Datto. We were founded in 2007, so we are about 11 years old now. Continue to grow around the world. We're up over 900 employees throughout 26 offices around the world, and we protect close to 400 petabytes of data. So it's actually one of the largest private clouds in all the world. We've got 9 data centers around the world, one in Reading, Pennsylvania here in the States, and one out in Salt Lake City, Utah. So all the data for the U.S. clients all stays here in the States. We do partner with strategic partners all over the world. We do have a great partnership with LDI. That's why we've agreed to do this webinar. And we did an in-person event just a few months ago. And they're a professional partner. So, you know, very strategic in the way that we deploy. And we do a lot of educational pieces just like this. And so the idea for the webinar today is just kind of to rethink backup. When you think about cybersecurity, you know, you think about a multi-layered approach, and most people, you know, spend a lot of time considering, okay, how am I going to prevent these folks from getting in, which is great. These criminals try to stay 1-2 steps ahead, but there's a lot of great products out there to stop these criminals from getting in. The question is, once they get in, what can you do to prevent them from really impacting your business? And, you know, what kind of leverage do these folks have? And that's really where backup comes into play here. And what the criminals are relying upon are that the companies that they attack are still have traditional forms of backup forms that have been around for decades now. And those, you know, include, you know, external hard drives, NAS devices to back up that data, tape, where you see a lot of folks still using tape. And now we've seen a shift to a lot of cloud-based backup solutions. It's great. You have a second copy of your data on another geographical location. But there are some limitations to that that the criminals know about and that they're always going to try to exploit. And so when you look at some of those limitations, first and foremost, the higher failure rates. I mean, if you're still using tape backups, studies will show that the failure rates on tape backups are in the 30s, 40% range. And so a lot of folks will spend some money and some time on backing up and not have true backups when they actually need them. And that really goes for a lot of the kind of over-the-counter style backup devices. Those higher failure rates are very potentially impactful. Manual testing is another really big piece, and that's not just somebody manually taking the backups, which obviously adds the threat of user error, but also who's testing the backups. I do presentations like this all over the world, and I ask the question all the time, how often are you testing your backups? And for the most part, a lot of companies are not. And without testing those backups, you really don't know whether that data is available to you, whether it's valid. And then you get attacked with a ransomware attack or any other kind of hack, and you go to restore and you find out, hey, my backups have been failing. And so that's one of the things that these criminals are going to rely upon. They're going to say, okay, even if we're going to assume that a lot of these companies are backing up their data, but who's testing it, who's taking it, all the rest. Probably the biggest piece of leverage that these folks have, because they're going to make the assumption that every company's backing up their data. Most companies are all around the world. But the issue is the recovery time. How long is it going to take you to recover from that backup? Most companies can't answer that question. They've never tried to do a full restore of their systems. And the criminals know that most traditional forms of backup are going to take several days, if not weeks. You know, I mentioned cloud backup, which is great. There's a lot of great advantages to it. But if you've got several terabytes of data up in the cloud, have you ever tried to pull all that data back down for a restore? You're looking at several days of downtime. And so what the criminals know is whatever they're asking you for in ransom, chances are that's going to be a lower cost than the cost that's going to be to you and the impact that's going to be for your company with that downtime. So I'm going to get into some of that details, but this is a key component. And then obviously, lastly, the risk of infection or theft. A lot of the traditional forms of backup, they're a little bit antiquated, and it's easier for these criminals to exploit that with infection. And then if you just have your one backup solution, and it's either at your IT person's home because they bring it home every Friday, or it's sitting in your office, there's still a threat out there of that actual theft of the device and taking your backups directly. So what does business continuity do, and how is that a little bit different? This is kind of a buzzword in the industry, business continuity. Obviously, you're going to have the advantages of doing these backups, but truly keep your business up and running and eliminate that last line of defense threat that these criminals offer. So we want to take advantage of the cloud solution, which is going to give you the advantages of having, you know, offsite, different geographical location. But what a hybrid solution means is you kind of have the best of both worlds. You've got an on-premise device backing up those servers and then automatically replicating it to the cloud. Obviously, I mentioned our data centers, one in Reading, Pennsylvania, one out in Salt Lake City, Utah. And the advantage to this is you've got three copies of your data now in completely different geographical locations. One of the biggest things that somebody told me when I entered the IT space is, regardless of what product you're evaluating, assume it fails. Assume it fails, and then what's the next line of defense? Obviously, your first line of defense is your actual users, right? You want to make sure that they're all educated, everybody in your office. You want to then assume that your firewalls and all the things up front are going to keep these viruses from getting in. Once it gets in, okay, how do I restore? Well, you've got an on-site solution right there that's going to help you with those restores. Okay, let's assume that that on-site product is incapacitated as well, whether it's just rendered incapacitated because you have a fire or a flood or whatever happens. Okay, well, now you've got a second copy of that data out in Reading, Pennsylvania. Okay, well, let's assume that that fails, or there's some crazy storm that's really taking out the entire Eastern Seaboard. What happens then? Well, now you've got a third copy of your data on the other side of the country. So multiple copies of your data in different geographical locations are key for really any backups, but it also is very critical in trying to eliminate some of these threats. Also, I mentioned user error, who's manually testing them. You do want an automated solution. Set your schedules as often and as aggressive of a schedule as you need those backups to occur, but also automatically test those backups. Make sure that the data is valid. Very critical. If you do have a failure in your backups, you want LDI and their team to be aware of that so that they can proactively go and try to correct those issues. An image-based solution is something that, you know, it's sometimes a little complicated to understand, so I'll try to simplify it as much as possible. Those traditional forms of backup, they're just backing up, for the most part, the files and folders that you're asking it to, which is great. But what an image-based solution does is it actually takes an entire snapshot of that server. So in addition to capturing the folders and files, you're able to capture the operating systems, the applications, truly everything that lives on that server is going to be mirrored over to that on-premise device and then subsequently replicated to those two data centers. So this allows us to make sure that we're not missing any volumes, right? We're taking that error out that maybe you're not asking it to back up a file or folder that it should be. You're going to capture everything, but it also gives us the capability to virtualize. And this is really a differentiator between traditional backup and business continuity. And I'll talk about how that is really a way to combat these criminals. But essentially what virtualization means is if your server is incapacitated for whatever reason, whether it is a ransomware attack, a fire, flood, natural disaster, we're actually able in a matter of minutes to spin up a virtual machine right from that on-premise device so that everybody that was operating off of that server that was infected now is operating off of this on-premise device. This is actually what is operating as your server. And so you're able to take active backups when you're in that state. It truly is business as normal. And so as I go through some of these threats out there, keep in mind that regardless of what's happening, you have a solution that's going to keep your business up and running, eliminate that downtime, that slow recovery time that we talked about. And so I've been giving ransomware-specific presentations for about 2 years now, most of them live presentations. And I'd go out a couple of years ago and do a ransomware presentation, and you could look out in the crowd, and people are looking down at their phones. Maybe they're Googling ransomware, but for the most part, a lot of people weren't too aware of it. As time has gone on, we've seen a lot more head nods, a lot more people have either been infected, had a client who was infected, another vendor, so on and so forth. And so more people have been kind of keeping the understanding of what's out there. But then last year, something happened that really put this on the front page of every paper, and that was the WannaCry attack. Never seen in the IT industry anything really like this. We've seen a lot of variants of ransomware, but never something as prolific as the WannaCry attack. And what this was a single virus in a single day was able to impact 220,000 computers worldwide. 150 countries were impacted. And so, you know, we studied it right away. And kind of this thought with the IT community was that this was a test, because what was interesting about the attack was that they only asked for $300 across the board. A lot of these variants, they're going to do some research up front. They're going to try to figure out the size of your company, the type of your company, the location, so that they ask you for a ransom payment that's going to be as much as possible. But this virus asked for $300 straight across the board, which meant to us, okay, this is just a test. And this is actually what the FBI came out with in the original statement, was saying, hey, we're looking for phase two of this attack. How are they going to monetize it? Because they only netted about $300,000, which might seem like a lot, but these criminals net about $1 billion a year. So $300,000 really isn't that much when you consider how many computers were infected. So I was given a presentation out in Pennsylvania about 2 weeks after the WannaCry attack. And the keynote there was a gentleman from the FBI, and he's giving some really scary statistics about cyber warfare and all the rest. And he finishes with ransomware, because obviously this is now the hot button topic of the day, and the audience were mostly small businesses from the kind of Philadelphia area. And so he presented what it was, and he came up with his first theory, which is what the IT community thought, that this was just a test. But he had a second theory, which at the time I didn't put much credence into, but as time has gone on and we've seen what's happened, I really think there's some real validity to this. That second theory was, these criminals didn't care how much money they made when it came to those ransom payments. Anything that made that $300,000, that was simply just gravy to them. What they really were trying to do was raise up the cost of Bitcoin, which several months ago may not have made sense, but as we've seen over the last few months, you know, Bitcoin has now become the story that everybody's talking about. And what these criminals have done for the last probably 6, 7, 8 years is they've been attacking a lot of people with this ransomware virus, and they always ask for the money in Bitcoin, because it can't be traced back to them. It's anonymous. And so they were collecting all this Bitcoin when it was, you know, $100 of Bitcoin, $200 of Bitcoin. And so think about the amount of money they had tied up into Bitcoin. And then let's look at what the cost of Bitcoin did. It's basically been pretty stagnant since its existence. Seen a couple of blips here and there, but you know, you look at January 1st, 2016, a single Bitcoin was $443. Fast forward to the following year, January 1st, we're looking at $998 on January 1st, 2017. January 1st of this year, it had skyrocketed to $15,000. And if you look at the trend, that first blip, when you start to see it go up, that was when WannaCry hit. That was in May. And so what happened was, you know, companies out in Europe, they were gobbling up Bitcoin, because they knew if that phase two came about, they wanted to be prepared to go out and have Bitcoin on hand, so if they're hit with ransomware, they can make the payment and keep their business up and running. So as you saw a lot of stories about the 22-year-old kid who invested in Bitcoin 5 years ago and became a millionaire overnight, and you saw some of the savvy investors who made a lot of money, those are the feel-good stories you read about in the paper. But the folks that really made a lot of money over the course of this time, the folks that really became multi-millionaires many times over, were these criminals. They'd been accumulating this money over the course of the last several years when Bitcoin was very low in value. So when that price skyrocketed, these were the folks that made all the money. And what's scary about this is twofold. One, it tells you how forward thinking they are, that they could make an attack like this and hope that something like this would happen. But also it shows you who's behind it. It's not the guy in his basement anymore. It really is organized crime. This is who's behind it. Organized crime here in the States, organized crime overseas, really all over the world. Organized crime has figured, hey, we can make a lot of money with a pretty simple delivery method of this ransomware virus. It's all going to be anonymous. We're not going to get caught, and we could make billions off of it. And that's what's been happening. And when you look at just the rise in of ransomware over the last several years, you know, ransomware has been around since 1989. So we're looking at close to three decades of the virus being out there. But it really didn't have this huge uptick until 2013. The image on the screen right now shows the more prominent variants of ransomware. The FBI will tell you there's close to 4 million variants of ransomware out there. And so, you know, people ask me all the time, okay, well, what's the government doing to combat this stuff? There's not much they could do. They could put a lot of resources into trying to shut down one of these variants, and they'll get a nice story and a nice pat on the back. Now they've got 3,999,000 to go, and there's new ones popping up every few minutes. And so they're trying to shift over to education. But what happened in 2013? Why all of a sudden, if this virus has been around for so long, why did we see such an uptick? Again, the answer goes back to Bitcoin. Once these guys figured out that they could combine this very easy to deliver virus of ransomware and combine it with Bitcoin, well, now they knew they had very little risk of getting caught. And we saw this huge explosion. And that's really when organized crime jumped in on this. And, you know, I mentioned that $1 billion number. That's a real number. That was the number the FBI came up with between July 1st, 2016, and July 1st of last year. But $1 billion changed hands. But when you look at the actual impact to the business community, it's closer to $75 billion. And what makes up this number is it not only includes the $1 billion in actual payments, but this includes that cost of downtime, that slow recovery time that I talked about. Businesses that are down for 2, 3, 4, 5 days, and you know, now maybe they're out of business or they're never able to recoup that money. And it also includes the cost of data loss. You're not guaranteed to get this data back. They say about 75% of the folks that pay get at least a portion of their data back. A quarter of them never get any data back. And within that 75%, some folks will get it back in piecemeal. Some folks will say, okay, great, here's your down payment. Now pay me some more money. And so the impacts, you know, the ripple effects of this are very great. When you looked at the two pieces of leverage these criminals have, it's very simple. And I know there's a million acronyms in technology, but the two I want you to take away from this discussion are RPO and RTO, because these are the acronyms that these criminals are very well aware of and that they're exploiting. So you look at the left-hand side of the screen, you see your RPO. What that means is your recovery point objective. Essentially, how much data are you at risk of losing at any given time? Are you backing it up weekly? Well, now you're at risk of losing a week's worth of data. And depending on your business model and the type of business you're in, that could be fine. Other folks need to be much more aggressive and have hourly backups and all the rest. The one caveat to that is if you're not backing up your data, there's no way you could possibly answer that question, because you could say, hey, we're taking hourly backups, which is great, but we're never testing those backups. And now you get attacked with ransomware, you go to restore and you find out, hey, our backups have been failing for the last 3 weeks. Now that star on the left has jumped from 1 hour to 3 weeks. So the first piece of leverage they have is obviously that left-hand side of the screen. They've encrypted your data. You can't access it. But let's just, they're going to make the assumption that, okay, people probably have backups and they could probably recover their data at some point. So maybe you do have a good backup solution. You're testing your backups. It's all great. Now you've taken away that left-hand side of the screen. You've taken away one piece of leverage. The second piece of leverage that they have, they know most people don't have a solution that can combat, is that cost of downtime. How long is it going to take you? Can you answer that question, how long you'd be down? And then subsequently, how much is that going to cost you? It's kind of hard to put a dollar value on that, but I'll give you some examples at the very end here. But that's the second piece of leverage that they have. They're going to price that ransom payment and say, pay me $5,000 or go ahead, try to restore your backups. It's going to be down for 3 days. That cost of downtime is going to be far greater than whatever they're asking for in ransom payments. And so keep that in mind as we move forward. We did a ransomware survey. It was the largest of its kind back in 2016, and we did another one in 2017, where we interviewed two groups of people. We interviewed folks in the managed services community, folks like LDI, and then folks in the small business community. And of those managed service providers, we knew the numbers were going to be staggering. I mean, 6 in 7 of them had at least one client victimized by ransomware over the last couple of years. We started this survey on July 1st, 2017. 6 in 10, 60%, had an attack on one of their clients in just the first 6 months of last year. And when you look at who's being attacked, you know, you read the paper and you're going to see stories about hospitals and universities and municipalities. Those are the sensationalized stories that show the really big payments that are being made. But for the most part, the folks that are being hit is the SMB community, because the criminals know they get through a lot easier and most people don't have a solution that can combat it. And so when we looked at the average payment, when we talked to the small business community, the folks that were hit, the average payment was around $2,000-$3,000. That's what they're asking for. So they're going to go for that low-hanging fruit, the folks that'll pay right away. And what's crazy is you look at the billion-dollar number, over 700 million of that came from the SMB community alone. So it shows you two things. It shows you one, that's who they're going after for the most part. But then again, think about $709 million. Break that down into $2,000 increments. Think about how many people that were not only attacked but had no other recourse but to pay. That's a gigantic net. Because what's creative about this ransomware attack is, you know, it used to be way back when the folks that were attacked, the only people that were being hacked were the folks that had data that was valuable on its own. They could sell it on the black market, financial information that could be used just to simply extract money from you, personal information that could be used for identity theft. Now with ransomware, they don't care what kind of business you are. They don't care what kind of data you have because they're not stealing the data. They're just encrypting it. They're relying on the fact that they know that you can't live without your data and you can't operate without having full access to that. So you're going to pay no matter what, regardless of whether you are a large Fortune 500 company or you're a one-man nonprofit. Regardless of what kind of business you're in nowadays, you need access to that data. So it really casts that huge net. And you know, when you talk to these small businesses about the impact, the ripple effects beyond just paying the ransom, 57% still reported a loss of data, and a staggering 3 in 4 of them reported business-threatening downtime. You know, there's a statistic out there that says that 74% of businesses that are down for a week or more are out of business within a year. And so you look at this number and you say 75% of these folks reported business-threatening downtime. That's where we start getting that $75 billion number. And what the stat that came out of a report that the criminals like the most is this one right here. 9 in 10 of those managed service providers that we interviewed were highly concerned with ransomware. We figure that. These guys live and breathe it every single day. But less than 4 in 10 of the small business owners were highly concerned. And this meanwhile, was done after the WannaCry attack. After this attack that was on the front page of every paper, lead story on every website, business owners still weren't concerned about it. The criminals were thrilled about this because they know that these small businesses weren't putting the proper procedures in place to make sure that they can combat this stuff. That's why we're going to see this continue to rise over the years to come. And so I told you I'd give you a couple examples. Most people have great backup solutions, right? So most people could say, okay, that left-hand side of the screen, I could take care of that. They don't have that right-hand side of the screen taken care of, that cost of downtime. So let's look at what that cost really is. The story that I've been telling over the last year or so was the San Francisco Metro Transit Authority. They were hit with ransomware on Black Friday of 2016. These criminals are very smart when they know when to attack. To their credit, they immediately put out a statement, public statement, acknowledging that they were attacked with ransomware, acknowledging that they were asked for $73,000. Their statement concluded by saying, we're not going to pay this ransom. Government recommends that we don't. We don't want to deal with criminals in this regard, but we also have a very robust backup system. We know we're going to get our systems back up online. And the systems that were hit were the transit system fare terminal. So they were not able to collect fares, either their bus, their light rail system or their bus system. And so they huddle their IT team together and they say, okay, it's go time. How long were we going to be down? I said, oh, we're very confident. We've done several tests on this. We know we can be back up and running by Sunday morning. So now they're facing 2 days of downtime, two busiest shopping days of the year, which really leaves them with two options. They could shut down the light rail and the bus system for 2 days, which would be really an option they couldn't go with. And so they went with option number two, which was, we're going to give away free rides for 2 days. We're going to give away free rides on the light rail and the bus system. Now, this now became a feel-good story. There wasn't a lot of follow-up because everybody in San Francisco was thrilled they got the ride for free, right? So they didn't see a lot of follow-up. So we never got to see exactly how much money they lost. But fortunately for us, they have a lot of information very readily available on their website. They claim that they provide 735,000 rides every day, according to their website. I'm going to assume that that number is higher on those 2 days, but let's just take their number. Now, they don't discriminate whether it's the bus system or the light rail. They just say combined, they provide 735,000 rides a day. I know it's $1 to ride the bus, $2.25 to ride the light rail. So they're down for 2 days. They're going to lose anywhere between $1.5 and $3.3 million in lost revenue. They could have paid the $73,000 meanwhile. Instead, they went with the other option of trying to restore from their backup, and they lost several million dollars. Now, they could absorb this, but it's that math that these criminals know every business they attack have to do. Can we pay the ransom? Yeah, that's going to be at a lesser cost than it is to be down for several days. This math, whether you scale it down to a small business, this is the math they want you to do. And I was actually doing an event in Manhattan with LDI a couple months back, and there was an FBI agent there. I had to go up after him, so now I'm hoping all my statistics are right. What was interesting was he used the exact same story. He talked about the exact same story. He said he didn't do this math. He didn't say, okay, let me figure out how much money they lost. Instead, he gave the example of, hey, we're in Manhattan. I don't know how much money they lost, but I could tell you right now, if we had the same attack in Manhattan, Manhattan would lose about $50 million a day. It would be a $100 million impact to New York City. Okay, so that's us and the FBI doing the math for you. But I'll give you another example, and that's what I'll leave you with, which is a real life example I heard is I'm sitting on a panel with one of the gentlemen on the panel. They were from a cybersecurity insurance agency, and they're talking about why you need cybersecurity insurance, which is a topic for another day. But he gave the example of a utility company out in Lansing, Michigan. They were hit with ransomware. They were asked for $25,000 in Bitcoin, and they had a very robust IT team. They actually had about 50 some odd folks on their IT team, had a very expensive backup solution. So they spent a day trying to restore. Spent a day using all of their resources to try to restore their data, get themselves back up online. And after about 24 hours trying to do that, they had no other recourse but to pay that ransom. The general manager came out and said this was the only action we could take to get our systems back up online. So that's what they did. They got a Bitcoin account set up. That kind of thing doesn't happen overnight. So it took a day or two to get that Bitcoin account set up, get the money funded, and then go out and pay the ransom. So all said and done, they were still down for 1 week before they got all their systems up and running, right? Down for 1 week. They had cybersecurity insurance, fortunately, so they put together a claim. And they looked at the 1 week and the actual impact of this, and they said, okay, this actually costs about $2.4 million. Now, they acknowledge in this claim, okay, $400,000 of that is for upgrades that we found that we needed. All the vulnerabilities that we saw were there. And so we need about $500,000 to upgrade all these systems. And they couldn't include that in their insurance claim. They had to just talk about the cost of downtime. So when they came up with just the cost of downtime, they figured that that was $2 million. That was the claim they put together. And so the insurance agency looks at the claim. They actually spent several weeks trying to figure out whether this claim was real. My experience with insurance companies is they don't necessarily want to pay out on claims that aren't real. So they did their due diligence. And at the end of the day, they went out and they cut a check for $1.9 million. There's a $100,000 deductible. And so this gentleman that was telling this story was looking at it through the eyes of, yes, thank goodness these guys had cybersecurity insurance. After we got off the panel, I picked this guy's brain because I was looking at it as, hey, these guys justified the story that I normally tell about the cost of downtime. So I said, hey, do you mind? I'm going to steal that story. The guy was great. He actually sent me some articles about it so I could kind of research it on my own. And so I'm looking at it as, okay, they did get this $1.9 million payment. That's great. Well, they had to spend $25,000 in Bitcoin, spend their time doing that. They still had the $100,000 deductible. And as I kept reading stories because I was fascinated by it, I found a story from about 6 weeks later, 6 months later, I'm sorry, where they said that 25% of their IT team, remember I mentioned it was over 50 folks, 25% of their IT team quit within the next 6 months because the environment there got too toxic. Everybody's pointing fingers at one another. It was way more time than they normally had to spend on things and just the money wasn't worth it, so they left. So now another ripple effect that this company had to do is go out and try to replace 25% of their IT team at a time when they're trying to rebuild their infrastructure. Anybody that's trying to hire really qualified IT talent knows that's not very easy to do. And so those are some real life stories of what that cost of downtime really is. The $25,000 ransom payment was far less than the actual cost of downtime that this utility company justified by submitting a cybersecurity insurance request. So think about those two examples and think about if they had a business continuity solution, right? Both of those companies were able to restore their data eventually and get back up and running, but they didn't have a business continuity solution. And remember when I talk about that image-based solution, if this represents your server and it gets hit with that scary red screen that everybody that's been hit with ransomware has seen before, click on this button to pay the ransom to unlock your files. If you are hit with that, because everything that lives on that server lives on that on-premise device, you're literally, it's a phone call to LDI and they're going to spin up a virtual machine in a matter of minutes or hours, depending on the size of your company. But again, we're talking about minutes or hours instead of days or weeks. You're going to get back up and running and it's truly business as usual. It's a true production environment. You're able to make changes to these documents while you're in this virtualized state. And you could be in that virtualized state for hours, days, weeks, however long you need to while that server is being either replaced or wiped clean. And once it's ready, we do what's called a bare metal restore, and we get all that information back onto that new piece of hardware, and including all the changes that were made while you were in that virtualized state, and truly get you back to where you were, not just when the attack occurred, but really where you were once you were ready to do this restoration. So you've now cut down that downtime, which again, remember, that's a big piece of leverage that these guys have. So the other benefit is you could truly answer that question. I mean, I want everybody from the webinar to go back and see if you could answer with whatever solution you have right now. And maybe that's a conversation you want to have with James and his team to say, what is our RPO? How aggressive is that? Aggressive enough for what we need? How much data are we at risk of losing? Well, here I mentioned you're going to have an automated system set up where you're going to be able to set your schedules, and we're automatically testing it. And the way we test, it's a little bit different as well. We have what's called screenshot verification. And what that does is it doesn't just test that the data's there, but at the end of the day, we actually spin up a virtual machine in the background and take a screenshot once we bring it up to a boot screen and send it off. And so we're not just testing that the data's there, we're testing that all these cool virtualization capabilities are there as well. So that you know when you come into work on the following morning, your data is valid and these virtualization capabilities are there as well. And that's very critical. And lastly, you have the ability to do it either locally from that on-premise device, but if that on-premise device is compromised, you could do it from either one of the data centers as well. So truly, no matter what's going on around you, you're going to not only have access to your data, but access to a true production environment to truly eliminate that downtime. So what a business continuity solution does is, first and foremost, it takes care of that left-hand side of the screen because we're taking backups, we're testing those, you're setting the schedules. But more importantly, it's taking out that right-hand side of the screen, which is to say, all right, we're going to make sure that that downtime is reduced as much as possible. So when these criminals hit you with this ransomware, you've taken away both of their pieces of leverage. You don't have to set up a Bitcoin account. You don't have to pay the ransom. It's truly just a phone call over to James and his team. So with that, that concludes the webinar. Here's James's email address if you have any questions.
Yeah, no, I'd just like to thank you, Michael. I mean, you always do a fantastic job of explaining the difference between traditional backup and true business continuity, and just let the people on the phone know that we have a significant amount of customers utilizing this solution. With the rest of the protections we need in place, thank God we haven't been in very many cases where we needed to bring them back up again. But it's just an insurance policy. It's the same thing. What, you have fire insurance at home? Yeah, we do. Why? Well, my house might burn down. To get insurance against cyber criminals is the same exact thing.
Great. Yeah, and again, if you have any questions, again, you really want to first answer that question of what does my RTO look like? What does my RPO look like? Can I answer those questions? And then go from there. It's the, obviously, James and his team over at LDI, they've got a lot of layers of protection. This is truly your last line of defense. So,
agreed.
But with that, I'd like to thank everybody for joining us. Again, any questions, feel free to reach out. And please enjoy the rest of your day.